Dzień dobry Państwu. Witam serdecznie na dzisiejszym spotkaniu.
Welcome to tonight's meeting. Maniacal Depression and Feelings About Neoliberalism is the title of our talk. The meeting was announced as a lecture by Rudy Lermans, but I have some sad news for you. Rudy Lermans isn't able to be with us for personal reasons, which are quite tragic. And he has only let us know a short time ago, so our reaction time was quite limited. And nevertheless, thank you for coming. We'll try to compensate for Rudy Lerman's absence. It will be difficult because the formula that we adopted, the formula of this meeting, it was to be a presentation of several projects that Ola Sikle carried out. She will show you these projects and talk about them. I will then invite the curator of the Free Gestures exhibition up to our podium, Agnieszka Sosnowska, and we will discuss the exhibition. If you've seen it already, that's fantastic. If not, I hope that this will be a good introduction and a good encouragement to come back to Ujazdowski Castle tomorrow to discover this wonderful project for yourselves. Without further ado, I would like to introduce. When tomorrow we'll be starting at 2 p.m. With performances. Our performers will start animating the space and the exhibition will open. So that's the mode that the exhibition will function in from Tuesday to Sunday from 2 p.m. all the way till closing time, and on Thursday from 4 till 9 p.m. I understand the question was for those who have not seen the project. The performers are on site all the time doing choreographic arrangements and reading, reciting literary texts. And the exhibition is that way, hence that's why it opens later than the castle itself. The whole meeting tonight will be held in English, so if anybody wants some translation into Polish, please pick up a headset.
So I would like to introduce our guests, and I'm really pleased that Ola Sikle is with us after the very intense evening yesterday. Ola Sikle and midnight. And so Ola Sikle is a Canadian artist of Polish origin who lives and works in Brussels. She is a performer, collaborates with many international theatres and venues, works, and her practice is based on the idea of sampling and work with pop culture and mainstream notion of images, ideas, and trends. So in that case, CCA Ujazdowski Castle, Ola Sikle, together with Agnieszka Sosnowska, worked on a very unique exhibition, I would say. Many of audience will try to understand that as a theater performance or contemporary choreography project, but nonetheless, this is the exhibition. But without further ado, Ola, the floor is yours. So I hope you will enjoy the presentation. Thank you very much.
Okay, can you hear me with this? All right, I'm gonna try and stand a little bit. We'll see how this goes. So firstly, I want to thank you all for coming. And I want to apologize for not being Rudy Lauermans, because I think it was a very nice talk we had organized today with Rudy, but as Conrad said, he was ill after the passing of his father, so I'm going to replace him, let's say, with another kind of talk. So Agnieszka and Konrad asked me to present a little bit my work and maybe the in French the parcours, so like the trajectory which brought me to Free Gestures, which is the exhibition that opened yesterday. So I thought I would talk a little bit about myself and my background and maybe introduce to you two other projects that are kind of in a way connected to the exhibition here. Maybe you could consider them almost steps leading up to this project. So I think maybe that's an interesting thing for you to hear about. And I will show you a little bit, so you don't have to listen to me talk only. You can see something on the screen. So maybe I just say really quickly, Konrad introduced me, but I'm a Canadian, born in Toronto. My mom is in the crowd, so we have some Canadians in the house tonight, today. But my mother's also Polish, so I have a connection with Poland, and it's now like the maybe third time or fourth time that I'm working here. So this is also really nice for me that somehow being Canadian, I connect to my Polish roots by working here over the years. I studied in Brussels in a school called PARTS, which is a performing arts research and training studios. It's a school which is run by the Flemish choreographer Anne-Thérèse de Kersmacher, who has a company called Roses. For people who are in the dance field, maybe this is familiar. I also studied art history in Canada before I came to Belgium, and then I also went to, please take a seat. I also had a chance to go to film school for 2 years, to the Frenois in Roubaix, which is a great school, which is very open actually to non-filmmakers, so artists from different backgrounds who want to work with media and image-based kind of projects, let's say films, but also installations. So I think this background is kind of maybe interesting for you because, of course, visual arts, image culture, media, but also kind of mainstream, let's say less fine art, image culture has been a big influence on my my trajectory as an artist. And somehow, even though, let's say, the core of it is dance and choreography, I very quickly wanted to kind of open up the genre of dance and the kind of, let's say, you know, the medium of dance and to broaden it, to connect to a larger notion of culture and movement and gesture. So that was something that's like, maybe since I graduated, has been a kind of impulse for a lot of my projects. Like, how can I at the same time be a choreographer and work on dance and on movement and be interested in my medium, which is the body, but at the same time, how can I kind of open the doors to a much larger idea of what dance can be? Because of course, growing up since quite young in the dance field, and I was in a children's ballet for a long time, and I did many, I'd say I was very involved in Canada even before I came to Europe. I noticed that the dance milieu is a small one. It's a niche. Let's say not like So You Think You Can Dance or these kind of Broadway shows, but like contemporary dance as a field is a very small one. It's a super interesting one. It's a field which is like very dynamic, and I think it's slowly gaining more audience and it's growing. Somehow growing up as a choreographer and in this dance field, it was like, I want to open the doors. I want to bring in all the things that I feel are not, let's say, maybe don't necessarily have a place in the contemporary dance field that I kind of came up into. Of course, now I've been working for 10 or 15 years, so the field has really changed since I started. But one of the aspects was, for example, pop culture, pop dances like hip hop, or you know, just really other kind of like street dances, which when I kind of graduated was still a bit, or like this feeling like, this is like, not really contemporary dance. This is popular dance. This is, you know, not the same thing as what Anne Teresa would do in Rosas on stage, or if you would go to the ballet, or, you know, so there was this hierarchy. So one of the feelings that I had was very much about, like, okay, how is dance circulating outside of the small, relatively small field of contemporary dance? What are the styles? What are the things that people are watching? And how does it circulate? So this is kind of a starting point. It's not such a smooth narrative, because actually one of the major influences for me was actually going to Africa for the first time and spending time in Kinshasa. So I just kind of some years after I graduated, was invited as an artist from the Flemish Royal Theatre to take a trip to Congo, the Democratic Republic of Congo, and to spend some time in Kinshasa, kind of accompanying the project of some other artists. And it was a really interesting moment for me, because it was the first time that I had left kind of Europe, North America, so of course very kind of eye-opening, but also just in terms of my dance culture, it really also was a very influential moment, because I found myself in Kinshasa and I thought, wow, this is going to be really exotic and different, but actually what I realized is that my culture, so that I grew up in, North American culture, was super present. When I was in Kinshasa, I found a kind of other sort of, let's say, kind of equally interesting dance history that was, you know, also coming in a way from court dances, like traditional African dance, we know came from the courts. There was, you know, royal families that had and a practice in the village, and so there's like a whole tradition of let's say African dance, but then also like how this dance migrated because of the slave trade, because Africans arrived in the U.S. and because jazz was born, and then people started to dance in different ways with different kinds of beats, and of course Broadway took this up and transformed it, and then in the 70s suddenly you had hip hop coming out. And so there was like this kind of really interesting lineage, you know, and then of course these dances find their way back into Africa and then they get remixed again with some idea of kind of traditional dance from the past. And so there's like, let's say, when I arrived in Kinshasa and I met some young people, I thought, oh, that's really interesting. Here I'm looking at a dance and it looks to me very contemporary because it's kinetic, it's got all kinds of forms and shapes, it's dealing with formal principles, but at the same time it's also so coded and it's so rich and it's got so many layers, just like the contemporary dance that I studied, you know, but it's another kind of archive, it's another kind of idea of the canon, let's say. So it's a popular canon, but equally interesting. For example, I mean, just as an anecdote, one very strong element of Congolese kind of pop dance is the history of the rumba, which came from Cuba. And because at the time of the liberation moment, the US turned their back on Congo and many other African countries, they looked to Cuba and Fidel Castro as a kind of figure. And so the rumba became like the national dance, you know, for a while. And still, if you go back to a generation that's maybe in their late 50s or something now, they would say the rumba is the national dance of Congo. So just to show you how globalization is like very much, you know, already since so many years, it's really a historical phenomenon, in fact. And another interesting thing, because I'm going to show you a little clip from Kinshasa Electric, the kids that I was working with, of course, they showed me the ndombolo, which is, let's say, the dance that came after the rumba, which came after liberation with this idea like, oh, we're going to go back to the dances from the village. But in fact, people haven't really been dancing these dances in so long, because Christianity has been around and it totally transformed the idea that people had of like how they presented themselves and how they danced. So to go back, they invented Ndombolo, which was a popular dance which was meant to reproduce the dances in the village. And of course, the generation who were dancing the Rumba found this like completely profane, like this kind of dance with no elegance. But that became the new national dance after the Rumba. And the generation that I worked with were really involved in the coupé décalé scene. So coupé décalé is basically you take guys from Côte d'Ivoire living in Paris who take a sample of Ndombolo music, sped it up twice as fast, and started to dance with these kind of crazy breaks. So coupé décalé means cut and break, cut and shift. Are my translators catching up with me? Thanks, guys. Just to show you, like, so you have the Rumba, and then suddenly, you know, this Ndombolo, this return to the village, and then the next generation right after is like, no, we're going to do this double tempo because we're global citizens. We want to get, you know, onto the global stage. So coupé décalé became, I mean, it's still kind of the dance of the moment. So, to make a long story short, I got really involved with this idea of working with young people from Congo, and I've made a couple of pieces now, two solos, Solid Gold and Jolie, for two dancers from Kinshasa, which toured for many years. And then after that, Kinshasa Electric, which is a piece for three young dancers from Kinshasa. And I would say that in the first pieces, I tried to kind of strip away the music and strip away the kind of colorfulness and to show the formal principles of the movement and amplified even that movement. So to give a kind of presence to the rhythms that are usually covered with music. And now in this piece that I'm going to show you, Kinshasa Electric, which dates from 2014, was premiered in the Kunsten Festival. We did the opposite, so we put everything back. So there's music, there's costumes. The performer who's doing the music on stage, her name is Daniela Berchon. She's German-Israeli, spent a lot of time in São Paulo and really into the baile funk scene, so she brought a whole other musical culture. And so the piece is, say, a 50 or 60 minute kind of crazy trip through the dance culture in Kinshasa right now, with some element of reality and some element of fantasy. So I'm going to show you a little clip from it, and then maybe I can talk a bit more. Am I going too fast, or is it okay?
It's cool.
Yeah? Okay, great. Sound. Okay. So I hope that just made what I talked about more clear. So maybe
this is the story of how animals hibernate in winter. Each character.
I don't know what that is. You can watch it on your own time. Okay, so maybe you noticed, so Kinshasa Electric, it's a little bit of a dream space for us. It's not, let's say, it's a piece that I wanted to make for these performers who I found really exceptional and quite incredible, to give them a platform to perform and to realize somehow their vision of themselves. So what was really interesting for me was, maybe you noticed the very first scene, but they are all on their telephones and they actually start to slowly play music together with different apps that we had downloaded. But what was really interesting for me when I met them was how aware they were of what was happening kind of in global pop culture and all the sounds that they had in their pockets. And somehow I wanted to kind of unfold this space that they were living in. I mean, they also perform in Kinshasa locally and they do kind of stage performances for marriages and weddings, but also for, I don't know, the launch of a new car. So they're constantly shifting between this commercial world and, but they just wanted to be on stage. So I wanted to find a way to kind of unfold this world onto a kind of stage and make it a platform for them to entertain and perform, but also sometimes to pull back and to sort of enter a more complex space and question a little bit this connection between the kind of commercial and the artistic aspects of what they do. And I think the next piece that was interesting for me kind of continued this story. So in Kinshasa Electric, there's a DJ on stage and she's actually remixing the music. But then I thought, I mean, we talked a long time together with the DJ, who's actually a visual artist and a musician. And we said, it would be really nice if we could somehow give this role of the DJ to the performers. So, and let them mix and remix themselves, and how could this become a kind of choreographic principle in some way? So, a choreographic principle at the micro level of the body, so maybe you can see that in a way, this kinetic idea of remixing was already somehow present in Kinshasa Electric. But then on the macro level, in terms of the whole structure of the piece, how could the performer somehow control this kind of mixed situation? So the next piece we made is called Extended Play. And I will show you a quick excerpt of it in a moment. But Extended Play was kind of the starting point was, okay, we're gonna take away the audience seating. So, I mean, when you go to hear music, you go to concert venues and stuff, usually you don't sit nicely in a chair, unless it's a classical concert. So we took away the audience seating and we wanted to put the audience kind of in the situation of being really close to the performers. And so we also took away the kind of technical booth and the safe space of the sound or the DJ, and we gave the performers tablets, so like iPads where they could basically, and we invented an app that they could use so that they could compose the music themselves, they could do all the vocals live, and they could add all the effects. So a lot of the work that we did was training them to be able to sort of compose both on a sound level as on a choreographic level. So I brought in a lot of sampled material, a lot of dances from the internet, a lot of choreographies that I thought were interesting. So we learned all this material. We learned existing pop songs. We learned the lyrics. We sampled the music. We remade the samples. And then the piece is kind of remixing. So what happens basically is that you might get a Kanye West lyric on a Nicki Minaj beat, or you might get suddenly a Eurythmics solo, just to go back in time, and then coming into I don't know, a Justin Bieber sample or something. So like it was kind of this playful way of mixing existing material, which was something that was already there in Kinshasa Electric, obviously, and we wanted to take this a step further. So the performers, in the performance, there's one of the performers from Kinshasa, Popole Misi, and then a cast of like American and European performers. All of them are somehow, they also have a musical practice next to their practice as a dancer or choreographer. So if it's okay, I can show a, am I doing all right? There's so much to talk about. So this is extended play. Also,
ça paie comme jamais, loulou et boutin, loulou et boutin, coco na chanel, coco.
Kelele, 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 aïe, kelele, 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 aïe, kelele, 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 aïe, kelele, 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 aïe. There is no Gucci I could buy. There is no Louis Vuitton to put on. There is no YSL that they could sell to get my heart out of this hell and my mind out of this jail. There
is no clothes that I could buy.
Sweet dreams are made of this. Who am I to disagree? I travel the world and the seven seas. I took a young sweet breath. Everybody's looking for something.
That's can't hear. Jordan's in a spear. Ted, how the fuck the thing?
Yeah, just to maybe sum up, because I think we're going to have a little conversation, yeah, and maybe some questions. I think we're arriving slowly. So Extended Play was really a collaboration between myself and visual artist and DJ Daniela Bershan. And what's really interesting for me was it came at a moment when this question about the sample and how, I mean, let's say until then I was working a lot on kind of personal dance histories and working with performers who kind of embodied and brought with them kind of an own archive or connected to another canon. So I was really interested in this kind of more personal dance history. And kind of through Kinshasa Electric and then the work with Daniela, the notion of sampling at large, popular culture and movement and material, image material, sound material in a larger sphere kind of became really relevant. So you can you probably recognized a lot of the songs or the maybe even the gestures or the maybe something felt familiar, but in fact in this piece absolutely everything is sampled, so there's no original material. There's only the interpretation that each performer gives to the material, which is of course highly personal and very kind of researched by us to find this kind of personal connection. But so it was, let's say, I think this principle of sampling had always been there, and somehow at this moment came like almost voraciously, like we just ate everything we saw on the internet. We ate all the music that was coming out at the moment. Daniela from her side musically and from my side choreographically, but often exchanging our focus points. And it became a really interesting moment for me because I also felt like I think we took a big step outside of a very specific box of contemporary dance, but also a kind of very specific box of what culture we're in, or, you know, I mean, let's say if Kinshasa Electric could still be sort of read as a sort of African-specific or Kinshasa-specific phenomenon. I think with Extended Play, we really took another step out of the box, and having one Congolese performer among many voices really kind of set something in motion in terms of like what world we're living in, this globalized world, how culture circulates, what are our references, how do we talk to each other, all these kinds of exchanges. So I think, to conclude, because maybe we're going to talk a bit about the exhibition now and maybe there's questions, but I think coming into the exhibition Free Gestures and the work with Agnieszka to prepare this exhibition, these questions about how do gestures circulate, how do our words circulate? How do, what is personal and specific, but what is also kind of generic and impressed on us from the way we use social media, from the way we devour or not popular culture, from listening to a song in the taxi to staying up all night in a club and dancing to a DJ set. So how these kind of this global culture circulates, and what happens at the level of our, at the intimate level of our bodies and our language, what do we kind of appropriate and what do we consider ours, even though it might actually come from the outside. So I think that was a bit the starting point for the exhibition Free Gestures, and maybe I can just say that the step off, away from the stage and the performing venue and going into a museum, for me, allowed me to sort of get a little bit more distance. So to get out of this mode of I have to entertain, which somehow still, as a stage artist, I feel very weighs on me heavily to have an audience captive. So of course, in a museum, you have this much more kind of individual experience of walking through and deciding, do I stay or not? Is this interesting for me or not? In a way, you become the DJ of the experience because you, you know, if in extended play, we try to make the performers the DJs, but in a way, I think the exhibition Free Gestures, it's the audience that are the DJs because you decide which room you stay in and you decide what you watch, and then you hear one text and maybe you'll, or you see a gesture and you'll hear another text. So I think that's maybe the where we ended up now and why the exhibition has this feeling that it does now. And it's very much an experiment and let's say well-researched experiment that Agnieszka and I tried to set up, and I'm really curious how it will go in the next days and how the performers will learn from this experience. So I'm going to stop there, and maybe we'll have another conversation.
Ola, thank you very much for the presentation, and I hope that at that point you are familiar with the practice and the idea which brings us to this point and the exhibition or project, I will prefer to say project rather than exhibition, project the Free Gestures, as you already said that we will, so I need to take my notes. I would like to start, maybe that was an open question to both of you. Agnieszka Sosnowska is a curator at the CCA Ujazdowski Castle, and well researched the notion of choreographic turn in the visual arts and curatorial practice. That's the main interest fields in the recent research. So I would like to start with the title itself, Three Gestures, and you, in the introduction to the show, you quote Flisser, who say that the three gestures are different than the movements which we get used to it and learned at work, like writing, typing. And for you followed in the exhibition, in the project, the notion of love, intimacy, friendship, as those which are free from the learned and taught ideas. So that's the one thing. What it is, the free gestures for you, both of you, and if you agree that we can say about the identity of the gestures and further on of identity and politics identity?
Okay, a light question to start. I was reading a book that a friend of mine gave me called Gesture by William Flusser. It's a phenomenology of gesture. So the quote that I say is that what I quoted was basically that maybe I can even read it because I think that's going to make it all more clear. Flusser defined gesture as a movement of the body or a tool attached to the body for which there is no causal explanation. He states that gestures must be distinguished from movements conditioned by nature, for the issue is freedom. He's a phenomenologist, so basically he's saying that a gesture is not the same as any movement of the body. It's not like, oh, I get punched and it's my reaction, I'm hungry and my stomach growls. A gesture somehow there's a choice involved, there's some kind of decision, and it's not necessarily completely causally explainable. So there is this issue of freedom, of free will, of choice. I think that's a quite beautiful quote of Flusser, because somehow it says that in a way gestures are free, yeah. Or they're made out of a free will choice. So in a certain sense, free gestures are, it's kind of explaining itself. But there we had kind of quite a, I mean, the title has quite some different angles to it also, because that was not necessarily the first one. Of course, when we started working together, we were talking about neoliberal ideology and this kind of capitalist, this moment in time when it's so pervasive that it seems quasi-natural that we live in a capitalist society, that we don't even imagine that there is another, I mean, or what would it be, or there's some ideas, but it's like, this total organization of time space has become so omnipresent that there's not so much an idea of what else it could be. So free gestures was also a kind of, we started with neoliberal gestures, and then I was thinking free world gestures. I mean, in Poland you used to say wolny świat for the West. So maybe this is wolne gesty is also Western or Western world gestures. And then just to finish, what I found interesting was a wolne is not the same as free. Actually, yeah. Wolne also has this
slow,
this possibility of slow. So I think free gestures, wolne geste, maybe could be Western gestures, or it could be free gestures, or it could be slow gestures. Mm. And that triple meaning is somehow what interested us at the end.
And I think like this.
Yeah, it works.
Okay. This trajectory, like which Ola just mentioned, that the title, like we work for many for many months. We started working. In fact, we were working on a title, neoliberal gesture.
Yeah.
But then we found it much too literal or much too a statement, and which really doesn't open like this space, which I would say like the artwork just needs. And it was, as it was developed, sampled a bit from Rudi Lehrmann's, one of the like recent book he wrote in collaboration with sociologists and philosophers, which title is like the, you have to help me, Ola, lexicon of management jargon?
Yes, exactly. Small lexicon of management jargon.
Yes, but then, really the title has traveled, and we had like quite a long discussion how to make it exactly like much more open and diversive in a way, so that it's very, as you may, it sounds just already, you have some contradictory in the title. Yes, it's also from one side, when you call some philosophers, you find argumentation how a gesture can be free. Still, when you just come from this to this like the very basic definition of gesture, that it's just a way of moving, that has a very like specific meaning. So it's like
it's unfree because it's codified.
Then it starts to be unfree, and then the the title starts to be like really in contradiction to itself, which we in general like this, that it's in fact this title, you can really, it's not so clear, and it can be just by itself puts quite many question marks.
Mm-hmm. As I went through the catalog which accompanied the exhibition is available in a bookshop, very interesting piece, and all the texts which performers play with during their action at the exhibition space. All of them, as I went through them, plus those two theoretical texts, all of them pointed to the notion of community, the new community, and the possibilities of global community as an opposition or resistance towards the actual changes in a political and social sphere. That's one thing. After that, most of the authors and you yourself pointed into the social media internet as a source of this new community, new society, but I have this notion that this is one of the main factor of this new liberal politics, new liberal philosophy, that everything is available, everything can be adapted, changed, sampled, but in some point, this internet and social media creates the barriers, creates the they blocked our notion of communication with each other. So my question is, how you will try to overcome this internet and social media as a main source at this project?
Well, like I said when I talked about extended play, the internet and social media is a kind of working tool. I mean, for many of us, it's a communication tool, but it's also like, I think for a lot of artists working today, it's almost impossible not to use the internet. I mean, you Google something to research, you know, we don't go so much to the library anymore unless you're really an academic. I mean, everything is kind of available online. So I think, just one thing is, besides my personal like life and how I communicate, like I use the internet and I use social media constantly. So it gets to the point also where it becomes a subject. And I think that started to happen in extended play. And then when I came to work with Agnieszka, and I started to, in fact, I thought I would work on that. Mm-hmm. I thought when I came to CSVU that I would work on the internet as a structure, and I would like, use this tool and try to make visible how information circulates, and that was going to be the content. But in fact, what happened was when I started to do the research and collect material, I was also writing a play at the time for Teatr Nowy, which was only based on sampled material online. I realized that the content was extremely formatted. So you have like this freedom because everything's at your fingertips and you can find all sorts of stuff, very diverse, but in fact, this kind of neoliberal capitalist ideology is like constantly coming back. Like, you know, you put happiness and you get 5 ways to be successful, or you put love and you say how to have a successful relationship, and you know, you get these pointers and tips, and you know, whatever you Google in a way, and pop culture is one aspect of this, but if you widen it, this ideology is very present. So I think the shift to start to work on the ideology and not on the tools or like on the social media as a subject was kind of an important moment. And then somehow the social media and the internet and all these structures and sampling is a kind of, I don't know, a background to it, or you know, the two things are in dialogue. So there's a paradox, right? Because we're online, so we connect, so we feel that we have more friends than ever, or we are more connected than ever. Somebody in Kinshasa can know exactly what's happening in New York City in the Vogue scene and learn every movement. You know, it's incredible. A young gay guy in Kinshasa who feels kind of slightly, quite oppressed because it's not, you know, he's not really accepted there, can learn exactly what a voguer made in the 70s in New York City when he had the same problem. So there's like an incredible possibility and an openness and a freedom for that young guy. And I'm talking about a friend of mine, but it's happening all the time in very different ways, you know, to access something, and that's through social media. On the other hand, there is a kind of alienation because I have almost 2,000 friends, but how many of them are really close?
So. No, exactly. So this, Agnieszka, the question is for you. What, how you worked and you've thought about the critical potential of this exhibition, of this show, and impact of criticism of neoliberal, how you will, how you introduce and worked during the developing the project and exhibition.
I think like the most important thing is which we, I think, defined very quickly with Ola, that like from our position, we don't want really like to make a statement which is like really like from one position, but rather to go in direction of polyphony and like opening the exhibition to really like many voices. That's why it has like this very like specific structures that is really like open to so many collaborators, and first of all to writers who are invited to write texts for performers, and those texts are performed in the exhibition, and each of these texts is really like written from a very different position. Yes, and very different perspective, and it's showing in a different way how ideologies, and especially like neoliberalism, come on our bodies, and they are visible in our language. But I think that's why those are not, for example, theoretical essays, but those are literary text. So it goes in direction of a fiction, but for sure into a, like something that is really like subjective, because I think you really cannot at the moment just talk about it from one perspective. So I would say like that's the first point. I think it's we're also
or from one perspective, or even one geographical point, because it's a global.
Yeah, but in this global perspective and different geographic points, one thing which is, I don't know if you agree with me, the common for all of those texts, depend on the ideology as well, is the nostalgia for the like closeness community and create the community, which, as you already said, that you have, for example, on the Facebook 2,000 friends, but who are the closest one, or like if there is a close friend, and what is the notion of communication of each other. And this is what is somehow lost in this neoliberal world, which actually the alt-right and neo-nationalism take back, is this simple notion of community and togetherness. And so the thing, my question is, how during this show or in the process of developing it, you try to create the notion or maybe strategies of close community and togetherness?
Well, Agnieszka already said that the project is a collaboration with many people. So that's already, I think, because it's always interesting to talk about like what it is about and how things are made. And I think already in the way we made the exhibition, there's quite a strong sense of it's not one artist's perspective only, but it's a polyphony of voices. There's a global perspective.
But did you have in mind any like strategies which will be outcome of this project?
But you mean like political statement, like towards the question
not
of...
Maybe not a political statement itself, and per se political statement, but rather the ideas, rather than a political clear political statement, because the political statement is not the notion of this project.
Well, the exhibition, I mean, formally it's made on a kind of double axis, so it's made with monologues, which are individual narrations. And the performers spend I mean, this kind of sounds literal, but they spend a lot of time in their spaces talking on their own, not in a conversation, so they speak. And then three times every cycle, they get together, and in these common moments, they have a task, but it's not a set choreography, and so they have to work together, and they have to kind of solve this situation together. So it's a very simple thing, it's not a very grandiose thing, but the exhibition is built formally on this idea of being an individual subject with an own narration and being part of a collective body and trying to navigate this space together in a public setting. So it is a negotiation each time. And the three group actions move from a kind of idea of four people taking care of a fifth or moving a fifth to the person in the center actually doing their own solo and being watched and being kind of heard by the group. And then the last action is this group caress, or maybe you could say the gesture of loving from Flusser. I was a bit inspired by the gesture of loving, but it's a kind of group caress of being, spending a bit of time, being, trying to be one body for a moment, even if it's a bit utopic idea. So there's, I think it's always difficult to say precisely what art can do politically in an active way in the world, but I can say that working closely with people and having to collaborate and trying to make visible the multiplicity of a kind of complex project like this, and that there are many voices, and that we try to work together, and that we do, this is already somehow doing something in the world for me. So there's this question of how things are made and what they're about, and we tried to put these two things together as closely as we could.
Yeah, I would here agree that if there is, like, if you ask where is here a community, somehow I would also answer that when the community was first of all in the process of working, you know, these people like who are trying to build community in aim to like to make the exhibition. And I think that's the place. I don't know if for audience when they go and like see the exhibition, I think they need to search it more in like this this field, which is like more based on the relation which are between the performers and this what is now hidden for them. So like all this process which came before, but that's why maybe this book, in fact, it's, as you will see, this is not a real catalogue of the exhibition, because it was published, in fact, before the exhibition was opened, but it's rather like a sort of documentation of work in process, so everything what happened, what is now in fact invisible for the viewers.
Including the people who renovated the space. And like, I mean, that's what's so interesting about making, you know, something like this in an institution. I mean, there's so many people involved at all levels, and how can you make this visible? What is the gesture of giving a value to somebody's work when they create a new floor for us, or when they paint a wall? I mean, it sounds maybe a bit utopic, but I think the project was like, how can we make visible all these steps? It has to do with also how I work personally with performers, that I really want them to bring their own personal movement histories, but also themselves to the work, that they have a chance to, I mean, they made a lot of their own material in the show, so I tried to expand this way of working to the different levels of the people involved and to make all these steps visible. So I think this is a kind of gesture also.
Yeah. You know, it's, you're asking a question, you put down the, in the book, you put the question, and I try to find the answer, and I hope, I think it's the open question, and I would like to ask you the question which you put on that in a publication. What is the gesture of resistance in a system which absorb any notion of resistance? If you can, if you try to answer that question, because you actually asked that to the audience and readers, but I think it will be that will be my last question, and then I will give the mic to the audience, and if there will be any comments and questions, you'll be free to ask. So, if you can try to answer to your own question.
Well, I have a personal notion of this because I really like Jacques Rancière a lot. It's a French philosopher, and he wrote a great text on the politics of aesthetics of politics. Mm. But he also says that it's always, I mean, the political or this moment of, it's always mobile. It's like you can't say, oh, it's this, because as soon as you say it's this, it's like taken up and it's gone. And it's not political anymore. You know, Rosa Parks saying, I'm not going to give up my seat on a bus, that was like a moment. And sometimes these moments have to be repeated and repeated to get through. But it doesn't mean that per se is a political gesture. It's very fragile in a way. It's like always contextual and related to what's going on. And so I think to answer that question, this question of sending it immediately the question out to five writers from different corners of the world and asking this question, I think asking this question is already part of it. Because the answers can never be, there's no one answer, there's no right answer. And it's a mobile answer, and I think it's just a question we have to keep asking ourselves, like, okay, in this context, what can I do to create some space, some emancipatory space for myself or for somebody who's in front of me who might not have the same context as me? You know, we are like in this moment when there's refugees arriving, and their sense of emancipatory space and mine or yours is completely different. So I think just asking the question, like, are you free? Is this comfortable for you? Is already like maybe the best thing we can do right now, and that there from there we will figure it out.
I cannot agree more.
I also totally agree, and I have also like this personal story, like standing behind, because at the moment when we were working at the exhibition, I was finishing, in fact, the book about the resistance performance. Mm-hmm. So like this question, and if I believe or not, I question it a lot, if it's possible to make such a gesture. I hope we can, but I also agree that the moment when you really tell what is it really starts to be eaten, and very quickly, like exactly, it's taken by the neoliberal ideology, so somehow...
I mean, they're selling Pepsi Cola with an image of a protest, you know? Mm-hmm. I mean, luckily, everybody got really upset and they took it off the, you know, but this, that's what's happening all the time, so.
So there's no way to openly and truly resist, and it will be commercialized and sell. Maybe some
but
of...
But I don't think so pessimistically, because, for example, the text of Jacob Wren, if you have a chance to visit the exhibition and you go through the main hall and to the right, it's a very beautiful text, and it's actually really interesting because he's like the biggest pessimist I know and also an incredibly smart person. He's a Canadian writer, a friend of mine. But in a way, he ends his text with so much hope. And one of the gestures is sometimes I have to lie down for what I stand for. So, you know, I think I have to get in the way of those who are not lying down. I have to make myself a block, an impediment in a movement of something. So I don't know. I think that there's lots of possible counter gestures, but it's just that they're not going to stay. You know, they're not. We can't fix them. We have to just think in the moment, like, you know, now I'm going to lie down. I'm going to stop access to this airport because Donald Trump says, the U.S. is no longer going to accept immigrants. I mean, you know, it's a country built on immigrants. So if a lot of U.S. citizens lie down in an airport, it becomes a gesture of resistance. So, yeah.
Yeah, but it's...
to end on a...
We could go into that and extend this discussion more into the... And the politics, if some of you would like to make comments, ask question, or try to answer that one particular question, please raise your hand, and I will come with the microphone. I will start from the back and going down.
Thank you very much for this question. I think it is a very, very, very important question. Unfortunately, it is very sad because I believe there are very, very few people who are aware of that question, first of all. Then there are very, very few people who are really trying to practice thinking about that question. And there are very few people who were able or are able to really touch the question so that it goes farther than the black and white box. So usually there is a concern that this question appears, but you know, its life is within a white and black box and is usually preaching to the converted, and the resistance is really somewhere else. People who really are involved in the gesture of resistance are not completely in a totally different time zone. You did mention the social media, but you know, medium is not the answer and is not the message. And I specifically refer to those long time ago written works. So I only would like to say, in your opinion, who are the people who are making those gestures right now, or who were? Who do you respect truly? I'm sure it's not Jeff Koons, and it's not probably anyone else who really is a celebrity in the art world. So I would like to ask a very sincere question. If you could tell me, who are the people whose work you really respect? Thank you.
Shall we gather the questions and you answer in a row, or you like to answer that straight?
I mean, it's always this question, like, what can we do in art, no? And like, is art and life like connected or not? And like, for me, the question is a bit irrelevant because I feel like we're all, you know, citizens and human beings, and whatever we do, whether it's in a museum or not, there needs to be a kind of consequence and a connection to. So this question of like, that's what I was trying to say earlier, like I have my personal feeling about what it means to resist or to, but it's maybe different at a different moment than somebody else. I think the question is about being aware and about trying to sort of acknowledge in each context, like when there's something wrong. I mean, that's why I like Jacques Rancière, because he talks about the political moment is basically making visible a wrong. It's saying that's not right. Like, you cannot talk to somebody this way if you are racist, or you know. But being there in the moment and saying, as a European community, I live in Brussels, and we receive like a huge number of immigrants coming in from Syria. And I mean, for me, the gesture of the people of Brussels and who stood up and said, no, we take people into our homes. I mean, those are the people that I really admire right now, because they're people who are saying, no, I make my personal space available. I take some discomfort and I take somebody into my home. And at the same time, I put my voice up and I say, no, this needs to be regulated. This needs to be dealt with on a national level, because it's a national issue, because the movement of people has been a European phenomenon since Europe, since ever, you know? It is a European phenomenon, and I think in Poland you know this very well. So I think it blocks us when we say, like, what can we do in the museum? I think if we think that just being in a wider black box is completely powerless, then I mean, why put that there? I mean, we work in a black box or in a white cube. We also walk on the street. We also have a house with maybe an extra room to house someone. I mean, we are total people. We're not just, you know, as an artist, I don't try to separate what I do in my work from what I do elsewhere, and I try to connect them as best as I can. And I try to, I value people who do that, and whether they are working in a completely different field as artists or not, it doesn't really matter. I think that's this notion of community coming back and things like this. So And art is a space for this. It's not the only space, but it's one space where we can talk about this. Journalism, fiction writing, filmmaking, working in a public institution, working for the government, working as a clerk in an office. I mean, all of these roles, there's always, you know, an aspect, an interpersonal aspect, a question of community, a question of agency. So why block ourselves? Is that a...
I have a question referring to your work process with the performers, because you've mentioned that there were some fragments of their own, but because I saw it twice yesterday, and I saw some common fragments, some common sequences, but also many different, and I'm really curious about the process of working with the text, with them, and with their own body histories, choreographic histories, because it's so dense for me, so fascinating that I'm really curious about that. I know personally some of them and their histories too, but not everybody, of course, and could you say something about that?
Okay, so, well, it always starts with this kind of who, like, I mean, for me, it was really interesting when we had to make a cast, and Agnieszka and I realized really quickly, like, shit, we have to do an audition, and I hate auditions, and I think it's like, but sometimes it's, you know, it's what you have to do, and so this project started with an audition, and then I kind of had a chance to meet a lot of performers, and what was really nice for me was that, you know, if I had just gone for a first casting, I would go for people maybe that I knew before, but suddenly I could meet really different people. So in some way, the project already started from this, and meeting these people and picking up, like, you know, what struck me in that first meeting. And in a way, I didn't see them again until we started to work. And in the meantime, I got the text from the author. So before even starting to work, I sort of tried to connect the text from the authors to what I had kind of caught or glimpsed from the audition process. I mean, I didn't meet everybody, but let's say I had, because there was a few people who came in later. But I sort of tried to connect the, like, some kind of feeling I had about a person to the text. And in a way, it was really weird with this project, because it was like I gave everybody their text on the first day of rehearsal, and with the exception of one person, like, nobody complained. Like, everybody sort of felt like, this text speaks to me in some way. So that was really like, it was a strange situation, but it was a very nice one. So from there, basically, I do this kind of process of training every day together, warming up. So there are some kind of collective activity that we do, and my idea is that if we're going to do this together for 5 weeks, something is going to change. We're going to get into the same wavelength in some way. So we did this kind of hardcore Kundalini yoga warm-up training. And then I brought in some collective materials, which were samples. So there's a kind of Isadora Duncan sequence. There's a kind of Nicki Minaj pop video sequence. We learned some Tai Chi together. And we learned, I mean, there was a few materials that were collective. Indian? We learned the Bhangra, which was from the text of Aman. It's a kind of Indian pop dance. So there were some things that we learned collectively. And then basically I gave them the text and I said, okay, now, I mean, I think not everybody does all the collective materials, but some of them do quite a few of them. And I asked them to connect, basically, from the text, what we'd been doing, including the warm-up. So, I mean, many of them sampled the warm-up in the performance. But then I asked them also, well, bring in your own, like, you know, think about it, you know, what kind of gestures or things do you connect to your text? And maybe sometimes they also went and researched, so one performer learned a part of Water Motor of Trisha Brown, because for her that was flow. Some of the performers asked for Tai Chi. Basically people, the patented gestures of Apple came up. So there was like, I think every performer had to sort of take the skeleton of the text and sort of flesh it out, like, you know, give it, embody it. And that process was, in a large part, their kind of propositions and then in dialogue with me. So literally, we had these group collective moments, and then we worked one-on-one. And every day, I tried to see at least half of the group. I mean, there are 10 performers, so it took a while, but to spend at least, I don't know, 20 minutes, half an hour, 1 hour sometimes with one performer or in groups. Because in fact, it's a double cast, so there's two performers per text, so we worked a lot in groups, and which was nice because then, you know, you have two different performers working with one text, and so they had also different angles on it and different information they, or different things they wanted to bring in. So, yeah. Does that answer? Yes.
All right. I'd like to emphasize perhaps a little bit that free gestures is not a matter of fact that will happen. These are choices every time, and considered choices. It's like sitting and walking away. It's like looking and closing my eyes. It's exactly, I can see million free gestures in those rooms of all these gestures and performances that these young people are doing, these artists are doing. And it takes time. We cannot expect of ourselves to have automatically embody free gestures, just automatically think like that. It takes time, sometimes maturity, sometimes just a laughter. But all in all, I saw lots of free gestures in your work. Thank you.
Is there any other questions?
Could you actually show us some gesture now?
from the exhibition?
Right now.
Well, there, yourself. you have all the scrolling gestures. I mean, there, you know, the thing is, this is a gesture. And there's a beautiful part in Anna Zed's text, and I hope you'll visit the exhibition to see it, where she says, where she's talking about like growing up and learning other people's gestures and appropriating them because she wanted to somehow. I mean, I think that's also how we, I mean, I think everything we do has a kind of, everything I'm doing right now is a gesture. That's what I want to say. So, if you want me to get up and dance, I would say no. I would say no. I'm sorry, but you can please go and see the exhibition, and you will see lots of amazing performances, moments of dance, but moments of also. I mean, maybe that's the last thing I can say to conclude that free gestures. What I think is nice about the title is that it's dance, but it's also much more than dance. So I think if you go to see the exhibition, you can see a lot of things. Thank you.
So, if there is any other comments or questions, I would like to thank you, Ula, for the project, Agnieszka as well. Thank you for this remarkable work, and thank you very much for today evening presentation and talk, and thank you very much you all for joining us, and have a lovely evening and the rest of the weekend. Thank you very much and see you soon.